Ara mātaki te kā ui tūro ki koutou te kā ui, e ui mai nei ki te wakarewa atura te neiata. Nau mai, haere mai. Nau mai, hara mai ki te kaupapa o te akamatua o te ture. I rungi tēnei, tau toru tukau e ngā tau e pā uri ake nei. Nō reira, nau mai, whakatau mai ki roto i tō tātou piri ngā whare, o te whare miere, ki runga i te marae o kaiota, ki runga o Waititi. O tino rā tuatai huri atu ki ngā tini aitua kua whetūrangitia. I tēnei wā ka huri te au whakaaro ki tōku pāpā, e tīraha kei rungi tōku marae o arohanui ki te tangata, e matua hone pukutapu e moi. E moi ki roto i tō ti wētanga e te matua, i taira wea ke anō ki te iwe te kaumātoru, i tō tau e no o nei ki roti te ao kiko kiko nei. Nō reire e te pāpā e moi, huri atu ki ngā tini aitua, are atura, are atura, are atu ki te pō, huri ki e tātou te ao. Tuatai e mihi rau atu ki a koe e te kāwana tianara. Nei rā te mihi e haramai ki te whakanui tēnei kaupapa a tāhua. Nō reira tēnā koe, tēnā kōrua me tō hōrangatira. Nō reira tēnā koe e te minita, nau rā i wātoro atu rā te whare nei, tēnā koe, tēnā kōrua, a tēnā e te tēpū nei, nei rā te mihi ki a koutou e whakarite, e nei te hunga e haramai nei, ki te tautoko tēnei kaupapa whakahirahira o te rangi nei, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, kia ora tātou kato. E ngā iwi o te motu nei, he raukura rā tēnei, i te tia nei e te ati awa, i te iti i te ra i te katoa. E ngā iwi o te motu nei, no o ia rā te wenua nei, mana ki tia ranga iwi, i te iti i te ra i te katoa. Kua tū a te witi, no runga i ana ma i pai, no runga i ana ma i tika, i tōna ngā kahu pai. This is the day of the raukura, a very special day. For the young, for the old, for everyone. To hold on to all those things, and the most important thing is to manaaki, to care for one another. And also follows in the righteous pathway of correctness. Ara, te ako matua o te ture, tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou, kia ora tātou katoa, e huri.
Nau mai, haere mai, haere mai, tēnā koutou katoa. Your Excellencies, Acting Chief Justice, Minister, Members of Parliament, Your Honours, Ms. Solicitor, Law Commission alumni and colleagues, members of the law reform community, distinguished guests. Good morning and welcome to our 30th anniversary symposium, The Law Reform Community in the 21st Century. First, however, I have to deal with some housekeeping matters which I'm required to mention. In the event of an emergency, please follow the instructions of the security staff. Secondly, and I do have to tell you this, the toilets are located over there. And thirdly, please ensure cell phones are switched off or turned to silent mode. It now gives me very great pleasure to invite Her Excellency, our new Governor General, the Right Honourable Dame Patsy Reddy, to address us. She needs no further introduction to an audience largely of lawyers, but I would like to mention one aspect of her distinguished legal and business career, and that is her close connection with and support for Victoria University of Wellington, especially its foundation and its law school, which we worked together on some years ago. Your Excellency.
Mm-hmm. Rōrangatira mā, me te aka mātua o te ture. Tēnei aku mihi nui, aku mihi maioha ki a koutou. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Thank you for inviting me to speak at the symposium to celebrate the Law Commission's first 30 years. While I've been invited in my new role as Governor-General, I note that my connection with the law has had several strands beyond this present one. I have been at various times a lawyer, a law teacher, a litigant as a corporate lawyer and company director, and an advisor on projects that have focused on or resulted in legislative law reform. From all of those perspectives, it's a privilege to be here. The Law Commission's stated goal is to achieve laws that are just, principled and accessible, and that reflect the heritage and aspirations of the people of New Zealand. It's a goal that resonates with all of us. I've experienced at first hand the various challenges that are associated with the crystallisation of policy objectives and social expectations into legislation. And as Governor-General, I find I have an even keener interest in the heritage and aspiration of New Zealanders. At the Law Commission's 2006 symposium, the Chief Justice relayed a comment made after the swearing-in of Sir Anand Sachinand as Governor-General. On hearing that the topic was the contribution of the New Zealand judiciary to the New Zealand law, the person she was speaking to remarked, "The contribution of New Zealand judges to law? That's easy. Judges apply the law." That led me to consider what the response would have been had the subject of that sentence been the Governor-General. The office of the Governor-General, in fact, is no stranger to the work of the Law Commission, given that the Commission is largely responsible for the most significant changes to the office in recent times. In 2010, Parliament passed the Governor-General Act, which resulted from the Law Commission's review of the Civil List Act. When the Commission's report was tabled, Sir Geoffrey Palmer advised that a new statute was required to reflect the modern office of the Governor-General and noted the vital importance of the office to New Zealand's constitution. The Law Commission saw both real and symbolic importance in having provisions related to the Governor-General in legislation separate from the equivalent provisions for members of Parliament. It also recommended updating the statutory language associated with the office to remove any remaining colonial overtones. But despite the familiarity of my office with the work of the Law Commission, discussions regarding law reform are still an intimidating subject for a Governor-General to embark on, especially after her first month in office. And the concept of a reforming Governor-General is one that makes the officials distinctly nervous. Ask me back next year. But today, after just 1 month in office, I can report that I already see that this role will give me a unique perspective on the law and law reform. Today I want to touch on the subject of New Zealand's constitutional arrangements, in which the Governor-General plays a significant part, and which are, of course, subject of topical and fascinating conversations. A consistent theme is a concern that our communities do not have a good understanding of how the authority of the state is exercised and where power resides. As recently as 2013, the Constitutional Advisory Panel reported that there was a serious lack of understanding in the general public about how the New Zealand Constitution currently works. One clear message was the need for better education and for more accessible information about how our constitutional arrangements and decisions are made. This lack of understanding is evident in the correspondence that my office receives, as it regularly includes demands that the Governor-General dismiss the government or particular ministers without delay. It seems to me that before we can talk about the Constitution, it's necessary to understand what is constitutional, regardless of the format in which it's presented. This presents a significant challenge and one to which we must respond if New Zealanders are to have a better understanding of the issues and to be able to engage in that informed debate. I think Parliament's trying to stop us having it right now, but I'll keep on going. I have a responsibility, as do you, in your respective role as judges, practitioners, and academics, to promote the importance of our constitution. And I use the term promote generally to encompass support, encouragement, and progression of the debate surrounding our constitutional structures. The domestic role of the Governor-General is made up of the three C's: community, ceremonial, and constitutional. And in my view, there's also a constitutional aspect of that community role. I say this because those who hold this office and those who support it over time must think actively about how the public understands the role. Already on a number of occasions when visiting communities or hosting events at Government House, I've been asked the question, so what does the Governor-General actually do? While I do use such opportunities to outline the scope of my role and point people to my Facebook page, at the same time, I wonder what can be done to ensure our citizens have a better understanding of our constitutional arrangements. All of us who work in law or in lawmaking know the importance of always keeping our key stakeholders in mind. And when it comes to the Constitution, our key stakeholders are our current and future citizens. We need to take every opportunity to engage with them. It's no surprise that technology is becoming a critical aspect of this engagement. In an age of online campaigns and crowdsourcing, online communities of electors expect to be able to exercise their democratic right to comment on matters being covered, considered by branches of government. I know these are issues that the Law Commission has already considered and experimented with. And Sir Geoffrey Palmer and Dr. Andrew Butler are to be commended for seeking to engage the public on their draft written constitution text through their website. Constitutional reform through crowdsourcing. Well, there's a thought worth pondering. The Office of the Governor-General has endeavoured to adapt to the new environment as well, and my time in the role has already shown me the value of social media as a means of connecting with the community. Indeed, our Facebook page has many friends and is now more active than our website. And through it, people can see immediately the activities that the Governor-General undertakes on a daily basis. But there's much more that can be done in this space. Perhaps a Law Commission Instagram account would provide access to a new audience for your law reform debates. Successful engagement, though, is not only about the channels through which we engage. It also requires an openness of mind. What Sir Eddie Dury has described in relation to researchers and Māori communities is the need to look inside their thoughts, concepts, philosophy, and underlying values, and to avoid interpretations from an outward appearance. The Law Commission, in making its recommendations, is required to take into account te ao Māori and to give consideration to the multicultural character of New Zealand society. For my part, I'm also conscious of my role as Governor-General in and over the wider realm of New Zealand. The communities belonging to Tokelau, the self-governing states of the Cook Islands and Niue, come to the Constitution with their own established historical, cultural and political reflections on what it means to be citizens of the realm of New Zealand and how they might be best served by future reform. A Māori concept that I think is especially apposite is kamura kamuri, We look to the past to inform the way we move into the future, and we learn from those who have gone before us. One of the strengths of the Law Commission's work is this ability to walk backwards into the future, to be courageous in re-examining legal frameworks and exploring law reform options, while respecting the deep-rooted principles, shared understandings, and culture that have shaped the course thus far. Similarly, the Office of the Governor-General is one that draws on tradition as it evolves to look outward and forward. The office comes with a good dose of cultural and legal history attached to it, as well as a significant amount of ceremony and symbolism. It can be easy over time to forget why such things are important and to question their relevance. But a dynamic living constitution allows for an ebb and flow of substance and practice and lends itself to constant examination of the principles that sit behind it. Over some time, matters considered to be constitutional practice may fall away or be so modified that they no longer continue to exist. But at the same time, practices that on first examination may appear somewhat arcane nevertheless survive because the historical impetus for their development or creation still resonates today. One such example is my regular Monday meeting with the Cabinet Ministers in their capacity as members of the Executive Council. There, I am advised to make regulations and other orders in Council, make appointments to public officers, and to consider other matters necessary for the government to implement its decisions. To the outside observer, this may appear to be an outdated or indeed redundant ceremony. After all, the business of the Executive Council can proceed in the Governor-General's absence, and the documents may be signed at a later date. However, a certain amount of constitutional meat hangs off the bones of this ceremonial convention. The meeting provides invaluable face-to-face time between a Governor-General and her responsible advisers, which helps to ensure they can work effectively together. It also allows the Governor-General to stay up to date with significant issues that have arisen in the preceding week. These exchanges are not long. In Sir Dennis Blundell's time, the one cigarette rule applied. This rule referred to the brief time allowed for Sir Dennis to quiz ministers after the formal business of the Executive Council was concluded. However brief these exchanges, and I assure you that the one cigarette rule is one convention that has fallen away, Executive Council meetings are still a significant part of the process to keep the constitutional engine fueled and running smoothly. To conclude, I point out that when we speak about law reform as it relates to the Constitution, we often talk about having conversations, and I think that's a word that has perhaps lost some of its impact in this context. In my view, the key element of a conversation is the exchange of informed ideas between the parties affected. In order for us to engage in that exchange, we must first learn by listening. I express my thanks to the Law Commission providing us with this opportunity to listen in order to learn, so that we can continue this important exchange of ideas. I'm sure that today will be made up of robust conversations, and I hope that your whānau communities and networks are a part of the subsequent discussions. Kia ora whihi tātou katoa.
Many thanks, Your Excellency, for your stimulating and insightful opening address. When I approached you before, well, when you were still the proleptic Governor General, I knew that you would do us proud by coming and opening our symposium today. And I'm sure I speak for everyone when I say how much we appreciated your insights into the Constitution and your office after 1 month, and without consulting my colleagues, something that I never do, well, I always do, I'm sure we'd love to have you back for the 31st to talk about your role as the New Zealand's leading reforming Governor-General. But thank you very much indeed. The attendance here today of you all in such numbers confirms, if confirmation were required, that interest in law reform in New Zealand is alive and well, and that we have assembled for you an outstanding group of speakers and panellists. I'm going to set the scene by endeavouring to answer, albeit briefly, three short questions. Why law reform? Why a permanent and independent law commission? And why a 30th anniversary? I emphasise that I shall be looking at the questions extremely briefly, and that at least the first two have been the subject of a large number of books one discovers almost on a daily basis, so that if anyone wants to read more widely, ask me afterwards and I can give you them, their titles. First of all, though, why law reform? I suggest that in a constitutional democracy such as ours, based on the rule of law, it is incumbent on us all to ensure that our laws are kept continuously under review and up to date to meet the needs and aspirations of our modern 21st century society. The framework of our government and most aspects of our lives are subject to the law, both statutory and judge-made common law. But much of it remains out of date. There are still statutes in force which were enacted over 50 or even 100 years ago. There are many more enacted before the advent of the digital age, with its impact on access to information and communications, and there are still court decisions which are binding precedents from past centuries. It is trite to acknowledge the advent of the digital age, but it is undoubtedly revolutionary, and the full range of its impacts on our lives and the law are only just beginning to be appreciated. Today, everyone is able to be online and have access to all existing information. I read recently that in 2014, 90% of all information had been created within the preceding 2 years. Worldwide, there are now 3.5 billion Google searches per day. Everyone communicates by social media. 100 billion emails are sent in the world every day, including Hillary Clinton's. In New Zealand, 2 million Kiwis use Facebook every day, including Her Excellency. And the Law Commission is now beginning to consult online. I'm not sure that we'd thought about Instagram, Your Excellency, but I'm sure we'll take that into account. And futurists tell us about virtual reality and artificial intelligence, subscription rather than ownership, and ultimately all surfaces will be screens and they will watch us all. Life will be far beyond George Orwell's 1984. For the law, we need to recognise that all New Zealand legislation is officially online. It is accessible to everyone and therefore needs to be clearly understandable. One question for consideration is whether hyperlinks should be added to the online legislation to enable court decisions interpreting statutory provisions to be readily accessible too. Conveyancing is online. Disputes may be resolved online. Perhaps court hearings too, as recently recommended in England by Lord Justice Briggs in his report, referring to an online court for the resolution of civil disputes involving smaller amounts of money. Should we be able to leave instructions in our wills for the permanent retention of our online footprints? I see you shudder. Or would we prefer them to be deleted forever when we die? Numerous law reform issues arise from these and other questions, including the security of the internet in the face of hacking and cybercrime, the unlawful use of the internet. As we all know, crimes are committed online. People are harassed and defamed online. Intellectual property rights are breached, and there is little privacy. All of these developments, along with many others, mean that the need for the law to be constantly kept under review has never been greater. Turning to my second question, why should there be a permanent and independent law commission? The answer involves a little history. In England, in 1963, after years of ad hoc and part-time law reform, two leading lawyers, Gerald Gardner QC and Dr. Andrew Martin, published a book called Law Reform Now, which advocated the establishment of a permanent and independent law commission. When Gerald Gardner became Lord Chancellor in Harold Wilson's government in 1964, the Law Commission of England and Wales was established as a permanent, statutory-based, full-time commission. Its first chairman was Sir Leslie Scarman, then a judge of the English High Court. 20 years later, as Lord Scarman, he came to a law conference in New Zealand and met the then Shadow Attorney General and Minister of Justice, Geoffrey Palmer. This meeting no doubt reinforced Geoffrey's view that New Zealand should have a similar law commission. In any event, when Geoffrey became Attorney General and Minister of Justice, he introduced the Law Commission Act 1985, which came into force on 1 February 1986, hence the 30 years. Its principal purpose was to promote the systematic review, reform, and development of the law of New Zealand. And it is with great pleasure I acknowledge Sir Geoffrey's presence here today. He recognised that to implement the purpose of law reform, a permanent and independent commission was required, one which, through its in-depth consideration of reform proposals and its consultative processes, would be likely to achieve the best outcomes. And the Commission's 30-year history shows this to have been the case. 70% of the Commission's reports recommending legislation have been substantially or partially accepted, and a further significant percentage have been implemented to a lesser extent. I appreciate, of course, that implementation is but one of a number of possible measurements of success on the part of the Commission, but that is in itself a chapter in another book. So I come to my third and final question, why a 30th anniversary? Because it is appropriate to pause from time to time to reflect on past contributions and to consider the future in a broader way than our daily focus on specific projects permits. In reflecting on the past, we acknowledge the work of former commissioners and commission staff who over the past 30 years produced some 115 reports relating to a wide range of references. We are delighted so many commission alumni are present today. I also particularly wish to acknowledge the leadership provided to the commission by my predecessors as president. First, the founding president, the late Owen Woodhouse, who in fact spoke 10 years ago at the 20th, 5 years ago. Kenneth Keith has sent his apologies from New York, where he is on United Nations work, and David Baragranath has sent his from The Hague. Bruce Robertson, Jeffrey Palmer, and Grant Hammond are all here today. In looking to the future, we are greatly encouraged by the willingness of so many of you to provide us, on a voluntary basis, with the benefit of your views and experiences for our current projects. We are also greatly encouraged by those who have agreed to participate today by giving their views and ideas in our wide-ranging sessions focusing on the future of law reform. We have enjoyed organising our symposium and inviting all our distinguished speakers and panellists to consider the challenges facing our law reform community. We look forward to your insights and your ideas for the future. I shall leave it to my colleagues, as the chairs of each session, to introduce their sessions and their speakers and panellists. Details of all are in fact in the booklets which you have. But I know we are all looking forward immensely to hearing from you. For this, the opening overview session, we have two speakers, neither of whom really requires any formal introduction. But I am delighted to invite our Minister, the Minister of Justice and the Minister in charge of the Law Commission, Hon Amy Adams, to give us her political perspective on the future of law reform. We are indeed fortunate to have, as our minister, a lawyer who was in practice for many years, who worked assiduously for the profession, including membership of law society committees, and who pays particular attention to our projects and our reports. And may the bells not toll for her. Minister.
No, mai haere mai. First of all, can I wish you a very warm welcome to Parliament. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, good morning, and thank you for the invitation to speak at your 30th anniversary symposium this morning. Can I begin by particularly acknowledging their Excellencies, Your Excellency, the Governor-General, Dame Patsy Reddy, Sir David, the Law Commission President, Douglas White, all of the current, past and present commissioners and staff of the Law Commission, the Acting Chief Justice and members of the Judiciary, and my parliamentary colleagues. I think that is all of the named people that I wanted to make sure we had covered off. Look, I wanted to reflect on the Governor-General's comments about the Executive Council. I was just listening to you speak, Your Excellency, and reflecting on the one cigarette rule. And I have to say I'm very pleased that that has passed into the historical realms of this place. I have the somewhat unique privilege of being the first minister who had to put a paper to Your Excellency at Executive Council. So there was no small bit of pressure when the entire Executive Council was gathered. And I was rather nervous that she would put me through my paces, but she was very kind and gracious, and I want to thank her for that. 3 decades for the Law Commission is a particularly impressive milestone for any organisation to reach, and of course this organisation is certainly one that is not only critically important to New Zealand, but very relevant to the work I do as Justice Minister. The Law Commission has retained and enhanced its respect in New Zealand over those 30 years. In this time, 116 final reports have been produced. There have been 7 Law Commission presidents who have reported to 11 different Justice Ministers, showing, of course, that your longevity is far better than ours. And throughout our legal framework, the Commission has made a very real difference to the lives of New Zealanders. I know that each of you work in this field or have an interest in it because you have a deep respect for our system of laws and an abiding wish to drive positive change. Like many of you, I've spent my entire career in the law, and indeed it was a desire to be part of shaping the laws of New Zealand that has led me to my current role. Over the past 30 years, the Commission has played a significant part in reforming our law and spearheading tough policy ideas through the decades. And its work has helped ignite those important national conversations. I was interested in the Governor-General's suggestion that better use of social media could be used for this purpose, and I was trying to get my head around how some of the very difficult concepts you deal with could be put into 140 characters, Sir Douglas, so that's something for you to go away and think about. But it's no doubt that engagement certainly is crucial. Law reform, like politics, I think is at its best when it's about leading and shaping debate and not just following the tide of popular opinion. And the Law Commission, I think, sits in a unique position of respect, independence, political neutrality, and expertise to do exactly that. The work that you undertake is greatly valued, and I want to pass on my deep gratitude to the Commission. I have to say that being the Minister responsible for the Law Commission is indeed a privilege, and is a tremendous responsibility. The appointment of commissioners in particular is a critical component of that, and I'm very mindful of the fact that the people chosen for those roles have a tremendous responsibility to New Zealand. We've certainly had a very, very strong group of commissioners over the time the commission has been in place, but I do want to note that I was particularly pleased in the latest round of appointments to be able to ensure we returned a good degree of gender diversity to the Commission, as I certainly believe that it is important that the Commission is reflective of New Zealand. I do want to take just a moment to reflect on a number of the reports that the Commission has produced which have led to some significant law reform. One very important piece of work was, of course, the broad review of the Accident Compensation Act in 1988. This led to a number of pieces of legislation in the early 90s, which strengthened the promotion of safety and rehabilitation and led to the inclusion of sickness as an entitlement to benefits and explained how accidents were defined. Another significant piece of work included a number of reports on criminal procedure through the 1990s, such as on juries in criminal cases in 1999 and on criminal prosecution in 2000, which have clarified important matters of criminal procedure in our courts and facilitated the fair, just, and speedy judicial resolution of disputes. A review of the law of coroners drew together the major themes of reconciling the public interest and effective determination of the causes of death with particular cultural, religious, and personal beliefs of many New Zealanders. The resulting report in 2004, of course, led to the passage of the Coroner's Act 2006, which established the Office of the Chief Coroner and systematised the coronial experience nationwide. A review of New Zealand's tribunal systems, including a report in 2004, as well as work alongside the Ministry of Justice over the period of 2007 to 2008, led to a number of important changes in the structure of our tribunals. These changes improved the efficiency, quality, and sustainability of the tribunal system by streamlining it and ensuring that it provides a more uniform and user-friendly experience for New Zealanders who access tribunals. And of course, your regular reviews of legislation like the Evidence Act, the Search and Surveillance Act, and the recent referral to you of the Property Relationships Act are a critical part of ensuring that the laws on our books continue to operate as society expects and that they remain fit for purpose. The breadth and complexity of the law reforms you undertake speaks to the talent and the skill of your people. For a relatively small organisation, you make a tremendous and lasting impact. More recently, some of your reports have led to major and ongoing policy work, three of them in areas of which I'm particularly focused. Firstly, modernising the Privacy Act to reflect contemporary changes in privacy law. Secondly, updating and replacing the outdated Trustee Act of 1956 with a modern and comprehensive Trusts Act. And thirdly, in an area I'm particularly passionate about, focuses on overhauling the way we as a country deal with family and sexual violence, from our laws to our court and evidential practices. I want to take just a few moments to look at each of these areas. The Law Commission's recent work in the areas of trust law and privacy law provide much-needed improvements to two acts that have become outdated and inaccessible through the passage of time. In 2003, the Law Commission was directed to review privacy laws. This project consisted of four different stages, culminating in the 2011 review of the Privacy Act report. The report recommended streamlining the Privacy Act and providing a number of additional safeguards to address challenges to the right to privacy in today's world of data and information sharing that the President referred to in his contribution. I'm committed to implementing these reforms with the help of the Privacy Commissioner, who I acknowledge here this morning, which the Law Commission identified in its report. These reforms are about incentivising private entities and public sector agencies to value early identification and prevention of privacy risks that could cause harm. These changes, I believe, will safeguard our privacy laws and give New Zealanders the assurances that they need to keep their personal that their personal and private information will be kept safe. In my view, it's about ensuring these updates strike a fair balance in the safe and effective sharing of information to help improve the lives of our most vulnerable with that protection of this core right. The Privacy Act is also being modernised, and this process is ongoing. Turning then to the Trust Act review, it is of course true that trusts are a critical part of our society and the economy. We're very heavy users of trusts in New Zealand, with between 300 to 500,000 trusts in operation. We're certainly moving to update and improve the general law that governs trusts for the first time now in nearly 60 years. This is about seeking to clarify the core trust concepts, such as what constitutes trusts and the duties a trustee has. The proposed changes focus on making trust legislation more useful, fixing practical problems, and reducing costs. It also aims to modernise outdated language and concepts. The reform, of course, very closely follows the Law Commission's aptly named report, The Review of the Law of Trusts. I very much want to thank the Commission for this detailed piece of work and their comprehensive review of trust law and the Act. The Commission, of course, recommended that an entirely new Trust Act be created, and I agree with this recommendation, as a new Trusts Act will help us to modernise the law of trusts to make it clearer and more user-friendly. Other recommendations in the report, of course, include broadening the scope of the legislation, modernising the existing framework, simplifying administration and accessibility, and the court's jurisdiction. We're currently working through the detail of implementing all of your recommendations, and we'll have more to say on this shortly. Finally, I want to make a specific mention of the work that you've been doing in recent years on the areas of family and sexual violence. Pieces of work that you've recently completed around exploring alternative trial practices for sexual violence cases, self-defence and family violence cases, and a new strangulation offence are critical components of the reforms that I'm contemplating in this area. And can I also acknowledge Judge Jan Duke and thank her for the work that she's leading through the District Court in this area as well. So I asked you to consider a non-fatal strangulation offence as a separate crime as part of this work. And in March of this year, you released your report recommending that an offence of strangulation should be introduced. As many of you will know, strangulation has potentially very dangerous consequences, with a loss of consciousness in as little as 10 seconds and brain death within 4 to 5 minutes. Victims can suffer cognitive issues such as amnesia, confusion, or agitation. Strangulation is a particularly important tool of coercion and control, with perpetrators strangling to show that they're able to kill or cause significant terror for victims. Studies have found that women who have been strangled by their male intimate partner, and it's almost exclusively women who are the victims in this case, were 7 times more likely to be killed by that partner than other similar assaults. 7 times more likely than other victims of domestic violence to be killed. In response to this, a large number of overseas jurisdictions have implemented strangulation laws, and the Commission here found that in New Zealand, strangulation is not always charged in a way that reflects the seriousness of this offending and is often not charged at all. And that's because there hasn't been a strong understanding of the risk and seriousness of the offence, that it leaves very little physical evidence, and that the injuries are unlikely to meet the threshold for wounding or injuring offences. I have to say that your work as a commission was a critical part of ensuring that the public came to understand the risk and severity of this behaviour and laid the foundations for my recent announcement that the offence will be created as part of the Family Violence Legislation Bill, which will be introduced to the House shortly. As recommended by the Commission, we are proposing that the offence will have a maximum penalty of 7 years imprisonment. It will recognise the risk and seriousness of the offending without a requirement for significant injuries to have occurred. The presence of strangulation on an offender's criminal record will give all professionals, in particular the police and the judiciary, information about a critical risk factor. This will enable them to better conduct appropriate risk management and safety planning. Of course, it's not all about creating a new offence. Operational changes, including the training of police, judicial staff, will have to be implemented alongside the offence to ensure that there's better understanding. We're still also working our way through two other important pieces of work you've produced in this area, around victims of family violence who commit homicide and improving the court experience of complainants in sexual violence cases. In closing, can I just make a couple of comments about law reform in general and picking up on some of the themes that the President discussed in his remarks. We are in a period of immense complexity. We are in a period of immense and rapid technological transformation and increasing cross-border issues. We're not living in the sort of simple, halcyon days where as a government you could make laws that affected almost everything that involved your citizens within your borders. Increasingly, the challenges we face are international in nature, they are complex, and they are fast-moving. And law is many things, but it is not particularly agile or fast-moving in response to challenges like that, which makes the challenge for all of us as law reformers even more real. I want to just share with you one particular example that I came across this week. I'm going through a period at the moment of trying to review our media laws to address digital convergence. And we talk a lot in the process of making law and reforming law about issues of future-proofing, which I always think is a fairly bold ambition when you're talking about digital convergence. And we were discussing how we future-proof the laws of how our communities access information and entertainment. And it was raised with me a speech that had been given by, I think it was the Netflix owners in the States, who were postulating that it wouldn't be very many years before our access to entertainment and content would be pharmacological, at which I paused and said, what? And the vision that they were expounding was that in not too many years, there will be a process by which you take a pill, which is customized to you, which allows you to hallucinate the entertainment program of your choice, and then you take another pill to return to normal. And I decided that much as I wanted to future-proof my legislation, trying to regulate for that at this stage was a little more than I am willing to take on. But that could well be a future project for the Law Commission, Sir Douglas. So, ladies and gentlemen, can I once again thank the Law Commission. As our specialist law reform advisor, you have contributed over 30 years to incredibly serious social issues, and you should be very proud of the fact that your work has made and continues to make a significant difference to the lives of very many New Zealanders already, and will continue to do so in the years to come. Once again, can I congratulate you on this milestone? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your stimulating address. We greatly appreciate your positive remarks about the Commission and its work over the last 30 years and our current projects. And I'm sure I speak for the current Commission, your remarks particularly about the implementation of the Privacy Report, trusts and family violence, we note. I can't let the opportunity pass, however, without picking up your comments about the future, which are, of course, highly applicable, and the concept of future-proofing the law and the two-pill story. What occurred to me, of course, is will anyone bother with the second one? But thank you very much indeed. I now have great pleasure in introducing the Honourable Dame Ellen France, recently appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of New Zealand. You will know her background from the brochure, but I would like to mention her special interest in law reform, both at the Law Commission in London, experiences which we both shared, but at different times. You can tell immediately that we are from different vintages, and then here at the Ministry of Justice. It also gives me great pleasure to invite her to address us, as she was one of my presidents at the Court of Appeal, and I'm delighted to ask her to give us her judicial perspective on the future of law reform. Dame Ellen.
Tihei Māori ora, ina mana, ina reo, e rau rangatiramā, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Your Excellency, Minister, Acting Chief Justice, President, greetings. I've been asked to talk about law reform from the perspective of a judge. As Sir Anthony Mason said, the phrase law reform is rather ambiguous. Sir Anthony says its literal meaning is changing the law for the better, but he notes that the expression is sometimes used in the sense of simply changing the law. In her paper from the Law Commission's 20th anniversary seminar, to which the Governor-General has referred, the Chief Justice said she saw no benefit in rehashing what she saw as the stale question of whether judges make law. Another commentator similarly notes that today no informed observer disputes that judges do make laws. It follows, adopting the broader of Sir Anthony's definitions of law reform, that judges contribute in this way to the law reform enterprise when their decisions change the law. It's also not in question that this aspect of the judicial function has its limits. I consider those limits today as a means of illustrating the role judges can play in law reform and in identifying the advantages a permanent law reform commission can bring to the law reform enterprise. Further, I think this consideration tells us something about the nature of the relationship between the judiciary and the law commission. To round out the picture, I also briefly consider examples of court-led law reform, and finally, I include some suggestions along the way about matters of detail for law reformers to consider, hence my title, Something of a Potpourri. In the writing in this area, there is general agreement as to the limits on the law reform function carried out by judges. The great bulk of these constraints arise from the nature of the judicial process and the need for judicial impartiality. For example, the judge will be dealing with a particular case in front of him or her and the party's particular dispute. Sir Anthony Mason puts it well when he says that the lawmaking function of the courts is not some sort of freestanding activity. And Sir Peter Blanchard has emphasised the random nature of cases which come before the courts. A further limit or constraint arises through the effect of precedent. One effect of precedent is that it lends itself to incremental change. Lord Nicholls in Re Spectrum described the development of the common law by judges in any one case as usually marginal. He continued that occasionally it is more far-reaching, and he referred to Donoghue and Stevenson as an example of that. Lord Nicholls also made the point that development of the common law as a response to changed conditions doesn't come like a bolt out of a clear sky. He says, invariably the clouds gather first, indicating with increasing obviousness what is coming. And I can't resist giving you the excerpt he cites from Cardozo's summary in the nature of the judicial process, when he said, the judge, and the language is a little quaint, even when he is free, is still not wholly free. He is not to innovate at pleasure. He's not a knight errant roaming at will in pursuit of his own ideal of beauty or goodness. He is to exercise a discretion formed by tradition, methodized by analogy, and disciplined by system. The other side of this coin is that limitations will arise because the parties may have organised their affairs in reliance on a particular state of affairs. Another constraint or limit arises because judicial decisions operate retrospectively reflecting the principle that the courts declare the law as it has always been. The court can sometimes be explicit about the timing of the application of new principles. An example from my experience on the Court of Appeal is that in adopting new sentencing rape guidelines, the court expressly stated the guidelines should be applied to all sentencing taking place after the stated date. The House of Lords in Respectrum debated the prospect of what it called prospective overruling. Lord Nicholls noted that there were various forms of prospective overruling, and he discussed in particular a suggestion from the European Court of Justice, which was that the effect of a ruling of that court might be expressed as subject to a temporal limitation that the ruling not take effect until some future date, so as to allow the state to introduce new legislation. Lord Nicholls was of the view that exceptionally the House of Lords might follow the prospective overruling approach. In terms of timing issues, I interpolate here that difficulties can arise for judges interpreting statutes where the legislation is unclear about transitional arrangements. I acknowledge the point made by the authors of Burroughs and Carter in statute law in New Zealand, namely that the draft is often in a no-win situation. He or she may be caught between the general guidelines and interpretation statutes and the complexity of detailed sections in particular acts. But if it is intended, for example, that a new regime apply to existing cases, that needs to be made clear. Areas where schemes change more regularly, such as accident compensation, can create particular difficulties. A recent example of the difficulties that may arise absent transitional arrangements in that area in relation to subordinate legislation is provided by Davis in the Accident Compensation Corporation. Mr. Davis maintained that his cover for a hearing impairment was governed by regulations in force at the time he applied for cover, under which he would have received hearing aids. The corporation said the claim was governed by new regulations which came into force after he'd filed a review of the corporation's decision on his claim, but before the review was determined. Under the new regulations, he would receive at most only a contribution to the cost of the hearing aids. In the absence of any transitional provisions, the matter had to be considered by interpreting the regulations, bearing in mind the presumption against retrospectivity. The High Court concluded the new regulations applied, but I'm simply suggesting that the issue could have been resolved by making clear provision. It's also commonly suggested that courts are wary of stepping in where the subject matter and issue involves questions of social policy. That will particularly be so where there are divided views in the community. There are a number of reasons for this constraint. The court will often not have all of the information that may be available to, by contrast, the Law Commission. Further, the judge cannot consult or engage with the public directly in the way the Law Commission is able to do. An illustration of this gap is provided by those cases, and I'm speaking from my own personal experience, in which the Court of Appeal sets out sentencing guidelines. The courts can, of course, be innovative in terms of the materials read in the preparation of the case, by appointing counsel to assist the court, and by allowing broader interest groups to appear as interveners in a particular case. However, if one considers, for example, sentencing guidelines in relation to drugs, seems to me there are a number of aspects of social policy involved which it's difficult for the courts, in the context of a particular appeal and sentencing guideline case, to canvass and address. The limits of the judicial process in this respect can be compared to the Law Commission's methods. The comparison is apparent from Sir Geoffrey Palmer's article, which described 12 points on how to organise a law reform process. Sir Geoffrey started with setting up an interdisciplinary team and emphasises the importance of consultation. Again, these are not processes the courts can draw in aid. An associated constraint arises where what is necessary is a more systematic overhaul of an area. It may also be the case that the issue is the subject of legislative intervention or Law Commission study. The impact of these last two factors is highlighted by the observations of Lady Hale in her dissenting judgment in a case dealing with the impact of a prenuptial agreement. Lady Hale raised a question about how far the issues about the freedom to contract out should be determined by a court or were better left to Parliament with the advice and assistance of the Law Commission. Lady Hale considered the law relating to prenuptial agreements was, as she put it so well, in a mess and was ripe for systematic review and reform. She noted that the Law Commission had a project on foot about the status and enforceability of marital agreements. She said this is just the sort of task for which the Law Commission was established. The Commission can research and review the law over the whole area, not just the narrow section which is presented by the facts of an individual case. It can commission research into the experience and attitudes of practitioners and the public. It can identify and discuss the full range of policy arguments, and it can examine critically their economic impact. In short, she said, that is the democratic way of achieving comprehensive and principled reform. Lady Hale took the view that it was not possible to resolve these issues in one case, especially one which she said had some very unusual features. I interpolate here that in a later speech, Lady Hale addressed the question, quotes, legislation or judicial law reform, where should judges fear to tread? Question mark. She did so in response to academic commentary on this case, and in her view, the question was one of institutional competence. I could give similar examples closer to home. The High Court of Australia grappled with similar issues in dealing with the implication of a term of mutual trust and confidence into an employment agreement. And in New Zealand, the Supreme Court considered this aspect in removing barristerial immunity in Chamberlain's and Lye. The court expressly addressed whether any change to the immunity should be left to Parliament, but concluded that it should not. An interesting exercise has been undertaken in the United Kingdom by James Lee. He analysed the references to Law Commission reports by the United Kingdom Supreme Court. He found that 48 of just over 400 decisions made some reference to the work of the Law Commission of England and Wales or the Scottish Law Commission. In the Australian context, in a speech on the relationship between the judiciary and law reform bodies, Justice Susan Kenny cites Brian Opskin's study showing about 60 to 80 citations of the work of the Australian Law Commission each year since 1998. As she says, there would be many more occasions where the judge consults its work, though this is not apparent from a published judgment. Even the few examples I've given illustrate, I suggest, that Lord Drummond Young is correct to describe the relationship between courts and law commissions as a continuing dialogue and an important part of the wider dialogue through which the law develops to meet changing circumstances. And this is the exchange or conversation that Her Excellency referred to. In yet other situations, the statute may govern the position and may be entirely clear, leaving no room to move in terms of further reform. I want to explore now further aspects of the constraints arising from legislation. I take as my main example a recent case dealing with the law relating to adoption. I do so for two reasons. The first is a personal one. As the President mentioned, I was a member of the Law Reform Division in the old Department of Justice. And in that capacity, I worked on adoption law reform and was part of a working group which produced a 1987 report on adoption law reform. I was also involved in providing departmental assistance when the Honourable Fran Wild's bill on adult adoption information proceeded through the House. And on secondment to the Law Commission in England and Wales, I worked there on the adoption law reform project. And I was very lucky to have as my team leader the then Law Commissioner, now Lady Hale, to whom I've already referred. So that helped develop my interest in adoption law. My second reason is that this is an area involving both statutory regulation and social policy. These are areas where traditionally judges' likely intervention in law reform is more limited, and the Law Commission's likely involvement correspondingly higher. It's also an area where human rights instruments are relevant, and it's interesting to consider how this impacts on judicial input into the law reform enterprise. Writing in 1956, one of our great law reformers, B.J. Cameron, compared the New Zealand judicial approach to law reform with that of our American counterparts. He saw the role of the New Zealand courts and law reform as, quotes, timid and conservative. By contrast, the approach taken in the principal adoption case I want to discuss is described variously as brave, interpretively controversial and aggressive, and surprising and significant. The case I will focus on is Re-AMM. It dealt with Section 3.2 of the Adoption Act 1955. Section 3.1 of that Act allows any individual to apply for an adoption order in relation to a child. However, when the application for an adoption order is made by a couple, Section 3.2 provides that an adoption order may be made on the application of two spouses jointly in respect of a child. The issue in Re-AMM was whether the word spouses could be read to also apply to a de facto male and female couple. And the issue arose because AM had a son. The father was unknown because the child had been conceived via a sperm donor program. But AM had been in a settled de facto relationship with KO for some 10 years, and KO wanted to become S's legal parent, but he could only do that by adopting S, but the effect of adoption is to terminate, would have been to terminate the mother's status as mother. As the court said, it kills off any existing parental status in favour of the new parents. So even though AM was already S's mother, she had to make a joint application with KO. In the High Court, the Attorney General accepted that the Act in this respect was without logic or justification discriminatory against de facto couples like KO and AM. But both the Attorney General and counsel assisting in the case took the position that this anomaly was a matter for Parliament to correct, not the court. The High Court therefore had to decide whether it could give a wider meaning to spouse than the norm. The court considered the answer to that question turned on the effect of Section 6 of the Bill of Rights Act. That section provides that whenever an enactment can be given a meaning that is consistent with the rights and freedoms in the Bill of Rights, that meaning shall be preferred. The High Court concluded that it was permissible to interpret the expression spouses to include a man and a woman who were unmarried but in a stable and committed relationship. It's instructive to consider the reasoning behind that conclusion. The court began with the application of the Supreme Court decision in Hanson, which deals with the approach to interpretation when Bill of Rights compliance is an issue. The court accordingly considered first Parliament's intended meaning, secondly whether that meaning was inconsistent with the Bill of Rights, and if so, whether that was a justified limit on the protected rights. If not, the court then had to consider whether it would give the word an interpretation consistent with the Bill of Rights. Given that the Adoption Act was enacted in 1955, at a time when marriage was, as the court said, the predominant relationship in society, the court said it was clear that Parliament intended the word spouses must refer to an opposite sex married couple. There was no issue in Re-AMM as to the next two steps from Hanson because the Attorney General had accepted the restriction was discriminatory and not a justified limit. In the context of considering the final step, that is whether the word spouse could be given a more rights consistent interpretation, the court accepted there were limits on Section 6 because of the principle of parliamentary sovereignty underlying Section 4 of the Bill of Rights. The High Court considered an extended meaning of spouse would not be inconsistent with either the text or purpose of the Adoption Act, nor did the court consider the implications of an extended definition were unpredictable. Accordingly, the court determined the word spouses could be given an extended meaning. As Paul Rishworth said, the operative principle appeared to be that the word spouse was amenable to an updated or ambulatory meaning. The court turned next to the case against an extended meaning. The High Court noted first that the Law Commission in its 2000 report on adoption had recommended allowing all types of couples to adopt. The Commission had envisaged reform being made through the care of children legislation, but when that legislation was enacted in 2004, it did not deal with adoption law reform. Next, the Civil Union Act 2005 made some consequential changes to the Adoption Act, but did not significantly include any change to the eligibility criteria for adoption. Finally, the court considered the impact of the Relationships Statutory References Act 2005. That act had amended over 100 statutes to update references within them to relationships. The Adoption Act was not part of this exercise. Further, an amendment had been proposed to Section 2 of the Adoption Act, which would have amended the definition of adoptive parent to encompass civil union partners, but that was not accepted. In other words, Parliament had deliberately not given the word spouse an expanded meaning, or so it seemed. The High Court considered it was plainly arguable that Parliament wanted to correct the resulting discrimination on its own timeframe, but nonetheless concluded that our task is to alleviate the discrimination now to the extent possible. That was because it was possible to reach an alternative meaning, and there were no reasons against such a meaning in the text and purpose of the Act. Rather, as the court put it, they are sourced in what can be termed deliberate inaction by Parliament. The court decided that was not sufficient to establish a Section 4 Bill of Rights situation. By contrast, in the earlier decision of Coulter and the Attorney General, the Court of Appeal had concluded that the term marriage in the Marriage Act 1955 did not include marriage between persons of the same sex. The High Court in Re-AMM took the view that Coulter was distinguishable on the basis that the issue in that case obviously engaged broad social policy issues. In addition, the existing law in many areas was premised on a limited meaning for the word marriage. There has been some criticism of the decision in Re-AMM. In his usual, if I may say so, thoughtful way, Ross Carter suggests that the High Court missed a very important aspect of the legislative history. He points out that the Justice and Electoral Committee's 1 March 2005 report on the Relationship Statutory References Bill referred to by the court discussed the meaning of spouses. The report said, "We recommend amendments to ensure that marriage is referred to separately from civil union and de facto relationships. We recommend also that a number of words should be defined or used only in the context of marriage. Spouse was one of those." Ross Carter says that an unqualified and undefined reference to spouses was therefore not intended to include civil union partners or de facto partners. His conclusion is that under the High Court's approach, Section 6 of the Bill of Rights has been interpreted to alleviate discrimination, but in doing so contemplates not just an awkward but a strained meaning of spouses unless the enactment expressly prevents that meaning. His thesis is that this new, more aggressive Section 6 approach had this, if this new, more aggressive Section 6 approach had been anticipated in 2005, Parliament might, to continue the current law, have limited spouse expressly. But given the use to date of Section 6 of the Bill of Rights, it may in 2005 have seemed impossible that spouses could be given a meaning that included different sex de facto partners. David Turner, in his discussion on the case, noted that the House of Lords and Guyden and Godin Mendoza, in similar circumstances to Re-AMM, had concluded that spouse in the Rent Act included same-sex couples. Mr. Turner's assessment is that the decision in Re-AMM seems to have tentatively favoured tilting the scales in favour of human rights. Subsequently, the Family Court has interpreted the Adoption Act as allowing of adoption by same-sex de facto partners. I should refer also in this context to the case of Adoption Action Inc. against the Attorney General. That case was brought in the Human Rights Review Tribunal. Adoption Action claimed that there were a number of areas in which the Adoption Act discriminated inconsistently with the right to freedom from discrimination in Section 19 of the Bill of Rights. The claim was largely accepted, and declarations made that in various respects the Act was inconsistent with the right to freedom from discrimination. The Human Rights Review Tribunal considered re-AMM, but concluded that it was not permissible to interpret the expression spouses to include civil union partners. The tribunal considered that to do so would be to apply aggressively what has already been described as an aggressive approach to Section 6. The government had to provide a response to the case, and in its report, the government, via the minister, has recorded that it did not agree with the tribunal's finding that Section 3.2 of the Adoption Act was inconsistent with the right to freedom from discrimination. And the government's response refers to the family court decision holding, as I've noted, that de facto partners in same-sex relationships fall within the definition of spouse. And reference is also made to re-AMM and to subsequent decisions of the family court applying that case and making joint adoption orders in favour of de facto opposite-sex couples. The report continues by noting that current practice by the Ministry of Social Development recognises same-sex de facto couples as legitimate adoptive parents. It's for the Ministry and ultimately the courts to continue to apply the Adoption Act in a way that reflects modern legal and social contexts, and that in practice results in rights-consistent applications. So essentially, as I understand it, the government's position is that the effect of departmental practice and of the court's approach is that the Act is being applied consistently with the Bill of Rights. And on that basis, the government said it wasn't moved to undertake large-scale reform of the Act at the time. It seems to me that what emerges from this discussion is that where protected rights are involved, the traditional constraints on judicial law reform, as I've broadly defined it, will not be as relevant. The statutory language obviously needs to allow for the rights-consistent meaning, but the direction to adopt a rights-consistent approach is an important one. In terms of implications for the work of the Law Commission, I suggest this raises, fairly obviously, issues about the specificity of the terminology the Commission may recommend is necessary to deal with a particular situation. It also reiterates the importance of considering how a specific proposal fits within the law more generally. Finally, it also suggests that the Commission will often need to do some crystal ball gazing in the sense of thinking about possible future developments and the possible impact of social change on the area of law in issue. This is the future proofing to which the Minister's referred. I should emphasise that none of this is news, and nor am I suggesting that the Commission isn't undertaking these sorts of inquiries, and the awareness of the need to do this is reflected in the opening remarks from the President today. I turn briefly to another aspect arising from the impact of legislation. In his article about the advantages of a permanent law reform commission, Sir Geoffrey Palmer discussed the room for flexible development of the common law, where the statute avoids minutiae in favour of what he described as carefully framed discretions. He gave as an example the development of family protection law, and that is a good illustration of providing flexibility to allow for future development. There are a number of examples where the modern legislative approach is for the statute to give the court a discretion and then list a number of relevant factors. From my personal perspective as a judge then asked to apply such a list, I venture to suggest that thought needs to be given as to how it is intended that this will work. For example, Section 30 of the Evidence Act 2006 sets out how the court is to approach the exclusion of improperly obtained evidence. For the purposes of assessing proportionality of exclusion to the impropriety, The Act lists a number of factors the court may consider. These include the seriousness of the offence and whether there was any urgency in obtaining the evidence, whether other means of obtaining the information were available. Plainly, factors like seriousness or urgency can operate both ways, that is, as favouring exclusion or inclusion. I'm not suggesting that this approach to drafting is necessarily a problem at all, but rather that the law reform exercise requires clarity of thought as to the outcomes sought and whether, as expressed, the law will achieve these outcomes. The other aspect I want to mention briefly is that law reform, in the narrower sense referred to by Sir Anthony Mason, may in some cases be judge-led. I see the High Court Rules Committee as a classic illustration of this, acknowledging that the committee has the assistance of members of the profession and assistance from Parliamentary Counsel in fulfilling its role. The establishment of the judicial office within the Office of the Chief Justice is another example. Justice Pamela Tait of the Court of Appeal, Supreme Court of Victoria, spoke in 2014 about court-led reforms in Victoria designed to reduce backlogs and delays in criminal reforms, the impetus for which came from a High Court of Australia judgment expressing concerns about delays in the Court of Appeal before the particular appeal had been heard. And there are other similar illustrations in the United Kingdom and elsewhere. Well, where does this legal equivalent of the musical mashup lead us? I offer the following conclusions. First, courts are one of the players in the enterprise of law reform, but there are constraints on the role of the courts in this respect. Those constraints arise in part from the nature of the judicial function and the nature of litigation. The limits in a particular case may also affect the reach of statutory regulation of the field. In that context, I've sought to show the impact of those instruments protecting human rights. Secondly, it's clear that the constraints applicable to courts as law reformers highlight the benefits of a permanent law commission. The processes of the commission can be better directed to explore all of the pros and cons of law reform, because of the ability to consult widely and to bring in particular expertise across different fields as required. Particularly where there is a need for systematic reform, I suggest the Commission will often have a critical role to play. Finally, I have attempted to highlight the ongoing nature of the dialogue between the courts and the Commission. Occasions such as this symposium are an illustration of that dialogue and an important part of it. Obviously, the courts and the Commission can each draw on the work of the other for the benefit of improving the outcome, whether it be the decision in an individual case or a proposal for broader reform in a particular area. In concluding, I think that the observation of the Chief Justice in Canada in discussing the respective roles of the legislature and the courts is equally applicable to the matters I've addressed. She puts the point in this way. Our efforts should be directed to discovering the proper parameters of action of these fundamental institutions to the end of building a stronger, more democratic and just society. And she ends, justice is an important business and we are all in it together. Thank you.
Many thanks indeed, Judge Dame Allen, for your excellent address, demonstrating, as always, the depth and strength of your research and the clarity of your invaluable insights. It would be extremely valuable to consider the points you've raised at the Commission, and particularly those relating to family law and our forthcoming Evidence Act review, the second one. The first session has concluded very efficiently, ahead of time, which isn't surprising when you observe three of the four speakers. This means that we will be able to pause in a moment and have morning tea, and I'm sure that the chair of the next session would wish me to say two things, two advantages. One, morning tea can be a little longer, but in view of the tightness of the programme and the fact that the next session has a panel and time for questions and answers, it would be a good idea to start 5 minutes early than is in the brochure, so you can get both longer for morning tea and an earlier start for session two. It remains for me to repeat our thanks to Her Excellency, Minister, and the Judge for their wonderful addresses in the first session to start the symposium today. And I'd now invite Their Excellencies have a very busy schedule and have to leave us now, but I'd invite you all please to thank the speakers again and then stand for them to leave. Thank you.